in exchange for information about President Trump's former lawyer and fixer, Michael Cohen. It's all part of the criminal investigation into payments Cohen made to a porn star and to a playmate ahead of the 2016 election. Each woman claims she had an affair with President Trump. He denies it. And remember, Michael Cohen said in his secretly recorded conversation with President Trump that Weisselberg would handle the payment when it came to payment time.
Need to open up a company for the transfer of all of that info regarding our friend David, you know, so that I'm going to do that right away. I've actually come up and I've spoken to Alan Weisselberg about how to set the whole thing up with
so what are we gonna think?
Funding. And it's all the stuff, because, you know, you never know where that company, you never know where he's going to be. Correct. So I'm all over that. And I spoke to Alan about it when it comes time for the financing, which will be.
Listen, what financing?
We'll have to pay you. So
I'll pay the cash.
No.
No, pay by check. Remember, the president first said he did not know about the hush money payments in advance. His then aide Hope Hicks said, "We know nothing of these payments." His spokespersons Raj Shah and Sarah Sanders both said that the president denied knowledge of the payments. Michael Cohen said the president knew nothing of the payments. Cohen's attorney, David Schwartz, said the president was not aware of any of it. 4 months ago, President Trump himself denied knowing about a payment. Asked directly on Air Force One, "Did you know?" "No." Now we know the president was not telling the truth. As for Weisselberg, reporters at the Wall Street Journal last month broke the news that the feds had called the Trump Organization CFO to testify before a grand jury earlier this year. The Journal reports Mr. Weisselberg then talked to investigators, though it's not clear from their reporting whether he ever appeared before a grand jury. What is clear is that the feds are tightening the screws. On Tuesday, the special counsel passed its first courtroom test when a jury found President Trump's former campaign chairman guilty of tax evasion and bank fraud. That same day, the president's former fixer implicated the president in a federal crime when he told a judge that candidate Trump directed him to pay off the porn star and the playmate. In Cohen's sworn testimony as part of his guilty plea, Cohen indirectly named the president as the man who directed his actions. The next day, when reporters asked Press Secretary Sarah Sanders about the payments, this was her refrain.
What I can tell you is what the president has stated a number of times. He did nothing wrong. There are no charges against him.
Sanders used essentially that same language nearly a dozen times in that one appearance. Then yesterday, not long after President Trump said in an interview that aired on this network that flipping should probably be illegal, we found out the president's longtime friend and CEO of the National Enquirer's parent company had gotten immunity for talking about Cohen and the payments. Remember, executives at the tabloid reached a deal for $150,000 to pay the former playmate Karen McDougal for her story, then never published it. So to recap, the fixer who ponied up and said the president told him to do it pleaded guilty to federal crimes. The head of the company that buried the playmate story flipped and is cooperating with the feds. Now the man the fixer said would arrange the payment, the chief financial officer of Trump organization, has flipped and is cooperating with the feds. The question, what are they saying to the feds? And beyond the payments to the porn star and the playmate, what did the president know? And when did he know it? Let's bring in Rebecca Davis O'Brien, who's a reporter for The Wall Street Journal. The Wall Street Journal's parent company and Fox News' parent company share common ownership, and Rebecca's been covering the Cohen story extensively. This development today, thank you.
Thank you for having me.
This development today that now the chief financial officer goes back more than 30 years with President Trump. Has turned state's evidence. How big a moment is this?
Well, it's a pretty big deal. Alan Weisselberg was the financial right-hand man and the financial gatekeeper for not just Donald Trump and his organization, but he had access to the family as well. He knows a lot of secrets. And it's a pretty big deal that he's speaking to the feds right now.
You don't get immunity without the feds first knowing to some degree what it is you have to provide them, right?
Correct. And we know that they had executed a search warrant on Michael Cohen and his home and office, and that they had access to his emails for a long time.
They got 3.2 million documents thereabout, audio tapes as well. Many of those have been with the Mueller team for a long time. Now, it would seem, at least from looking at the way this lays out, that Weisselberg would be one who could either confirm or deny or knock down the Cohen statements.
Well, Michael Cohen, in his plea on Tuesday, said that, and in the plea documents themselves, said that it says that Alan Weisselberg was, or Mr. Weisselberg was one among the people who helped, who worked to approve that money, the repayments for those women. So we know that he had familiarity not just with the business, but the particular transactions that were alleged or charged, and to which Michael Cohen pleaded guilty on Tuesday.
I think it's important, though we know this, to remember and report often that this is not an investigation, a story of, an unfolding drama of a man's personal dalliances outside of his job. This is not a story about that. The question at hand here, the issue here, is did the president, in an effort to sway the results of the 2016 election, commit a federal crime when he gave hush money or directed the hush money be given to women who were accusing him of things and might be able to hurt him in the eyes of the public before the public went to vote? This isn't about any sex. This is about trying to influence the vote. And that matter could be very serious.
Yes, it is.
How do you get, clearly Cohen is part of this quilt that the Mueller investigation is putting together. There are a lot of people now who seem to indicate this is a money matter.
Well, this is not the Mueller investigation right now. This is the Southern District of New York, and what they have been pulling together is the investigation was in part there, and six of the eight charges to which he pleaded guilty on Tuesday were related to Michael Cohen's personal business dealings. Mm-hmm. But the two that have of course become the most central and visible right now are the campaign finance violations, and what he has alleged is that he directed or helped facilitate those payments at the direction of then candidate Donald Trump.
And if that is the case, that's implicating the president in a crime, has been reported in your paper and on our network. And it's, some have further said, prosecutors who've been on our air have said, were he a citizen, a private citizen, he could be charged. But since he's the president, that's sort of a gray area.
Yeah, it is a sort of a gray area. And I think there's also a question of what was known about, how much did the president, if as alleged he knew and was helping to direct this, how much did he know? Did he know that what was happening was potentially designed to influence an election? There are some gray areas there, and of course Mr. Weisselberg is in a position to potentially fill in some of the gaps.
Rebecca Davis O'Brien from WSJ and WSJ.com. Thank you.
Thank you.
The Trump Organization could soon be facing yet another investigation, this time involving the president's former fixer and the playmate, or I should say the payment, to Stormy Daniels. The New York Times reports these would be state charges so that, for instance, presidential pardons could not apply. Laura Engel with the news. She's live in our New York newsroom. Laura?
Hey, Shep. We could be looking at a domino effect stemming from Michael Cohen's guilty plea in the federal case with additional state charges. Now, his federal guilty plea included breaking campaign finance laws with those payments to women who claimed to have affairs with President Trump before he took office, as Rebecca Davis just noted. The New York Times is reporting the Manhattan District Attorney is considering criminal charges against the Trump Organization and two senior company officials in connection to the hush money payments. The Associated Press reporting one of those senior officials might be Alan Weisselberg, who allegedly reimbursed Cohen for the Stormy Daniels payment through the Trump Organization, marking it down as a legal expense. Remember, Weisselberg's immunity deal is only for the federal case. This situation could lead to state charges. The AP also reporting that New York's Attorney General has requested a criminal referral from the state tax department, which subpoenaed Cohen the day after he admitted to evading federal taxes. The question there, whether Cohen misstated his income on state tax returns as well, Shep.
Hey Laura, there's word that the National Enquirer kept a lot of this damaging information, the details of all the catch and kill stuff,
yep,
in one place, in one safe.
In one safe. The AP is reporting this tabloid-worthy headline. This broke last night. We've reached out to American Media Incorporated and their lawyers, which owns the National Enquirer, for comment on this report. So far, haven't heard anything back. And this news coming after our sources confirmed to Fox yesterday that federal prosecutors granted immunity to National Enquirer Chief David Pecker, who, as we know, is a longtime friend of the president. According to the report, the Enquirer kept this treasure trove of documents inside a locked safe that contained details of hush money payments. Decker, the Inquirer CEO, allegedly paying for those damaging stories about Mr. Trump and not publishing them in that practice that you mentioned, catch and kill. The paperwork, there's another interesting part, was removed from the safe by Pecker and the company's chief content officer just before Mr. Trump's inauguration, according to this report. What exactly happened to those documents is still unclear, Shep.
Laura Engel in New York this afternoon. Sad news now. You may have heard Senator John McCain's family today announced he's decided to stop medical treatment for his brain cancer. The 81-year-old revealed last summer that doctors had diagnosed him with an aggressive form of the disease. He's been at home in Arizona since December. Peter Ducey live on Capitol Hill. Peter?
And Shep, even while Senator McCain has been away in Arizona trying to get better, he's been weighing in on the big issues of the day here in the Senate with paper statements. But this one came from the McCain family, and part of it says John has surpassed expectations for his survival, but the progress of disease and the inexorable advance of age render their verdict. With his usual strength of will, he has now chosen to discontinue medical treatment. His daughter, Megan, tweeted this: "My family is deeply appreciative of all the love and